locked in the T. Now I'm lighting up the street. Ain't nobody else banging, making a dance. Since Sunday morning band, got the club on jail. However, if a man ain't coming to the light, PDA be all aboard. Lost the fight, you feel me right? Lace the track like a machine. Who needs the Pro Tools when you dream, mama? Who needs a dope thing when you sing, la la? Haters give me love, too lazy bass, nada.
Remember old times when we used to have testimonial service?
Oh, you remember.
Thank God for my life, and health and strength. And the Lord is worthy.
Good morning. It is 11 o'clock. The OG's alive and well. We are so pleased to be here this week. Last week we took a pause for the calls, and every once in a while we want to get away, like most of you do. But we couldn't stay away, so we'll back today with some new information. You know, we always got something that's inspiring, informative, and healthy. We believe that you need to be healthy to have a job. And we believe that everybody needs a job who wants one. And if they don't have one, they will have to wait. They don't have to wait because we got one for them. Today, Don and I got a guest coming on, but, you know, since he's a little late, you know, we think that he's a little late because, he didn't have a clock. But whatever it is, we're going to move on with it. My name is Lewis Jackson. I'm your co-host. To my father is Don, and we brought you by the Russian Firm. That is Fred Russian Law Firm, takes care of all the legal matters. You know, down there in Florida, they got mighty needed.
They got what?
You know, down there in the Trayvon's case, they might need our lawyer because we got one of the best ones.
Yeah.
And, of course, we also brought to you by Miss Betty, takes care of your house if you need one. And if you got some clothes that they don't get clean as you think they should, and they're not as bright as they ought to be, we have the best detergent. We got the best cleaning supply. And our fabrics often making it feel and smell so good. You touch it and you smell it and you don't want to take it off. Just that good. Well, if you don't know how to make sure your products look the best, you don't have a good advertising agent, and you thought that you would have to have second-class advertisement, AZ Imprint will imprint your stuff. It looks so good. It should not be legal for this stuff to look so good. He takes the greatest care of it. That is A to Z imprint. They will imprint your dream. They will imprint anything. They got over 500,000 products listed. And if one of those don't fit your fancy, just call him and he'll find out and he'll make it. You know, he got the best graphic folks. He got the best artists. And he got folks that will go any part of the world to find what you want. Just give them a call, A to Z Imprint. Now, one thing that we have not talked about this year that we were going to get into, the original, the founder, and one who thought up A to Z Imprint has created, well, I know three words we already got that we talk about. And the fourth one is, I guess, incubating when it working it and coming up. What you call that? If it's a woman, they call it the cocoon. But if it's a word that he has been working on lately, of course, A to Z. Aggressive was the first word that he started, and that was 3 years ago. Every year he developed a word, and we gonna have to talk about that sooner or later.
Yeah, in a couple of weeks.
A couple of weeks from now. Now, Don.
How you doing today, Mr. Jackson?
I'm doing good.
Good.
How was your week, buddy?
Had a good one.
You know, yesterday I was down on the farm, and it's amazing how the landscaping and all can change in a matter of years. Down there where we grew and we plowed the mule, now we cutting trees off of it. You can't even get back down in there because the paths that we once knew are no longer there. And it just, you know, it breaks your heart to know that. Sometimes when you go back to your roots, you can't find your old roots. But, you know, we still got some land down there. And, you know, and the good part about it, we took farmers down there. And these are some minority farmers who want to change the way we as a people are doing farming. We're going to do some experiment with some stuff. And we're going to do some community gardens and stuff down there and teach folks what modern farming is about.
That's a good idea.
Of course, you were invited, but you did not. You claim you didn't get the word. But if I deliver directly from me to you, somewhere in between, you know, things happen like that. You ever been, you know, a long time ago when you were in class and the teacher would give you, write something down in the beginning and tell them to go around the room before you get back there, it's already changed. And so I guess that's what happened to that word. Maybe I was
no, that's wrong. Not what happened, Mr. Jackson.
Don, tell me one thing. I got one other question.
One of the two things happened.
I want to know one thing, Don.
That means I can't talk until I answer what you asked me, right?
No, that means that you need to introduce yourself. You're Don Farman. You're the host of the show. And why you were not here last week. I had an excuse. I was out of town.
I think you got it wrong.
I was out of town.
No, you weren't out of town. You were in Gwinnett County. That's not out of town.
I was out of town. Let me ask you, what's that? If I live in Atlanta, if that's my town, and I'm in Decatur, am I not out of town?
No. You just out of pocket.
No, I'm out of
You're
town.
You out your pocket. I was out of town last week.
What were you?
And but I'm back, so.
Let's talk about you from Florida.
Okay.
Let's talk about the Trayvon case for one moment. Then we're going to move on to some important stuff because we got a presidential race that's running. And, you know, these things we need to, you know, give our personal input. Ain't got nothing to do with the station.
Yeah, thank you.
This ain't the station. This is independent thinking from me. So what do you think about now that they locked his aggressor up? He said that he was not the aggressor, but we know that Zingerman was the aggressor, and he's in jail with the second degree murder. What do you think?
I think he should have been arrested. I was glad to see that. But what we as a people need to get on to is we need to get more into the political arena, because actually he just pulled the trigger. The law killed him. And the reason I say that is because that law is set up, even though it's a version of it here in Florida, I mean in Georgia also, not the same identical one, but one that's very similar. Those laws have been pushed through by the NRA to make sure that those kind of things take place. And when the laws are being passed, we're passive. We don't say anything. We don't do anything. We just say it's okay. But we are reactive kind of people. So once something has happened, then we want to do something about it. But at least we react. And I always said that...
what you mean, at least that, we react?
Well, because...
See, I got a problem with reacting.
Well, me too, but if you don't do nothing, what do you have a problem with?
See...
So you either react or you proact.
Let me tell you why I have a problem okay. with reacting. Usually, the reactors are the ones that probably hadn't voted. Chances are they are reacting for a cause other than the root cause. And let's take the reaction that they got down there with Trayvon. Now, of course, Jesse Jackson, anywhere that he can further his cause. Now, the reason he's there, because that's his job, he's getting paid. Now, what we should have done, this...
Okay, we. Who are we?
We as a people.
Okay.
We as a people need to make sure that we are always, and see, because, you know, I know that sometimes it looks like that we are totally in fault in most, I mean, we are totally innocent in most times we are. But we got to know how to protect ourselves sometimes. See, you know, if a man got a gun, sometimes you got to ruin. You know,
get back to the reacting part, because you lost me.
Well.
What's your problem with reacting? Because you got to do something. Something has already happened and you didn't do anything prior to, then reacting is the only other thing you can do, isn't it?
No.
What?
There has to be a solution. And the solution has to be...
The solution was, when the law was put forth and passing, we should have done all that we've doing now. We should have done that then for that law not to pass. See, what people don't understand is with the NRA, they got a lot of money. They push a lot of bills through. They got lobbyists. That's all they do is to get through.
Well, you won.
I'm an NRA member. Best thing I could have ever done. Best thing, because the only way you're going to be able to defeat somebody is to know what they're going to do. And I'm able now to understand what their whole agenda is. And their agenda is, like they got that law passed. And who can't get guns legally? Who can't get license for guns? The majority of the folks. Just take a guess on who they are. And take a guess on who can. So who's going to handle the guns?
Well, if you got a criminal background, I don't know. I don't.
So what they're doing is they're putting laws in place to legally kill us. And we're sitting back not doing anything. Yep, I'm going to say it again. They're passing laws that can legally kill us, just like that guy did. Legally shot and kill that guy. You know, and that's the kind of stuff.
Well, if he did it legally, why is he locked up?
Well, he did it legally in the sense that he could carry a gun and he could feel threatened. What he did illegal was the fact that he really wasn't being threatened. He instituted the threatening force by following the guy.
Had he not got called, if he had not called the dispatch and they told him not to do it, he would have been in.
He would have been scot-free.
I agree with that.
Totally free.
I agree with that.
By law.
I agree with that.
And that's what's getting me, though. There's just a lot of bills that's being passed. The current Georgia legislature just passed another law, and I talked to you about it, where they confiscate guns that have not been committed, that have not been into a serious crime. Once that they can release them, now they're going to have to sell them back to arms dealers. So now that means that the guns that were taken from the people, and you know who they're taken from mostly.
Well, you can come back and get your gun if it was not involved in a
crime.
Right.
So do now, you know how hard they make it for you to get your gun back?
I don't know.
I do. My wife left a firearm in a rental car, and they immediately, as soon as the Cadillac dealership found it, they immediately turned it over to the police department, which was the right thing to do. But what happened was when she called to get her gun, they was like, well, you can't get it now. You got to wait. And she waited, and she did everything based on what they said. And when she finally went down to get it, they said, you really want this gun back? Like, she was going to say no. And I said, you tell them, yeah, you really want your gun back. So they said, well, it's going to take 2 days. They do everything to deter you enough not to get your weapon back. And finally, we were able to get it back by going down there and being patient and being adamant about the fact that we wanted the weapon back, because they would have taken the gun. They would have turned it over to, they're supposed to destroy them if it's committed in a crime. If it's not committed in a crime, now the law says that they can resell them to firearm dealers.
Yeah.
So firearm dealers can go in and buy them. And do you know any folks of your color, that's firearm dealer?
Well, that's what we are doing. So, now, like down there on the farm, what we are doing things now is to do what we have not. Now, we had a...
let me tell you what you... Let me make a suggestion. I don't even know exactly what you were doing and how you do it, but you guys need a lobbyist. You need somebody to be down there to tell those folks what you want and to fight for it and get bills passed so that things can be done to help us, because that's what they're doing. All of these people of non-color are making sure that they get things in place for themselves.
Well,
and
we got to do it as a people. We brought a couple county extension agencies down, you know, and really, and you're right, because when he starts saying, if you do this, we got to do that, you got to do that, you got to do this. I said, why can't I just do it? It's on my property. Well, according to the law, this right here is wetland, and it has to be doing that. If you want to move so many trees, because you got to make sure that it ain't washing down. I said, I can cut it. No, you can't.
You own the land. You don't own all the rights to the land. The law owns the rights to the land. You own the physical part of the land. And they can tell you what to do, what not to do, and all of that with it.
And so a beaver had dammed up the river down there. I said, well, you know, one of the big creeks down there in water. I said, well, how can we do that? Well, you got to get a permit to cause that's a beaver.
Mm-hmm. Protected.
I said, that make no sense. It's my land, my creek. He's the intruder. He ain't paid no tax.
And eventually what happens to the farmers, of course, which you already know, and the land, is that you get so many of these fees and so many of these things added to you that you can't pay them. And it gets higher and higher, and taxes get higher and higher, so you end up selling the land to make sure that you can at least pay the taxes on it, pay the taxes on some of it, parts and portions. But this system is, man, this system is really, we got to get some folks and get some laws change, and we gotta stop selling out. Some of our politicians is going down there and selling out.
No politicians selling out. No politicians doing what they think they need to do.
Yeah,
no, we gonna
right.
take a pause for the calls. Yeah, see, you start talking.
Yeah, you know, because you know
we won't get. We gonna take a pause, and we gonna have our guests since we see two of them have shown up. We gonna let one of them come on up here and tell us about some of the things that he has done for people like you and I, who getting older, and you know we don't always eat the right stuff, and we don't. Even though you and I look better than most of them, because we do work out a little bit.
Yeah, we still bad.
Yeah, we still bad.
We're gonna take a break. You gotta get ready for the big
payback.
So we're going to introduce our guest. We're going to talk about some health issues right now. And I just looked at the title of his book, and then I thought of something. I was like, I guess this show is going to be on how to become a senior citizen. Because nowadays we got a real issue with that. And middle-aged and senior citizens, weight control. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to, and this is living proof here. No, I'm going to take care of that, Mr. Jackson. You just hold your mic. I got that covered. Just follow directions. But We are just so pleased to have this gentleman with us today. I met him a couple of weeks ago, and you're talking about impressive. The one thing I like is he doesn't have to open his mouth to be impressive. You can just look at him. He's impressive right off the bat. So today we're just very glad to have, as our guest today, someone that's going to help us, truly help us, and give us some ideas and some suggestions on what we can do to stay here just a little while longer. And for some folks, they really need to stay tuned. But I introduce all my guests the same way, so I don't forget their names or mispronounce them. You know more about you than I know about you. So if you just tell everybody who you are and why you're here, we'll move forward.
Thank you, Don. My name is Henry Morgan. I'm here because I was invited by you to come here. I am asked quite often what my age is, and as of this moment, I'm 79, but my birthday is September, which would bring 80 if I'm that fortunate. I don't know exactly what it is that you want me to get into right now. I have written a book and a DVD, did a DVD which is in back of the book, and this all started many years ago, as is explained in the book itself, actually as a teenager. And the reckoning day came in January of 1953. I was in the military and I had 6 months. I'd been in Germany for 2.5 years, for 2 years, and I had 6 months to go. And one day I was going, this was on a Sunday afternoon, I dressed and was going downtown to do everything wrong. And I went downstairs, and as I crossed the full-length mirror, I had a quick glance at myself, and I stopped, very hesitant to back up. And when I did, what I saw literally made me nauseated. And I went back upstairs, pulled off my clothes, got in the bed, and this is about 6:30 in the afternoon, got in bed and started trying to figure out what had happened. Because when I went in the service, I was weighing 148 pounds. And the very next day it was confirmed I weighed 190 pounds. So that's where it started. It's all in the book. It's actually a booklet, but virtually my whole life is chronicled in it, including the bad part, meaning that over the years I was able to control my weight simply by controlling food portions and exercising. But what I was putting in my stomach was the bad thing. It was fried this, fried the other, and the whole bit. So even though I was fairly slender, my body was in turmoil. And in the year, I'm skipping a little bit, a lot really, in the year 2000, I went for my annual physical. And the doctor told me, as we sat there, he said, your blood pressure is fine. Your cholesterol levels are very good. But what we don't know is what happened while they were all out of whack. So I want you to take this exam. He said it's relatively new. I think it was an MRI. But anyway, in Atlanta, in North Atlanta, I went to this imaging center and had this exam. And in 3 or 4 days, the doctor called me with the results. And he said, I got your results. And it shows that you have 13 blockages in your arteries. And I said to him, well, I'm dead. And he said, no, the machines are not yet sophisticated enough to determine the severity of the blockages, but that's what we have to find now.
The MRI is the one that showed that.
Yes, I'm assuming that was MRI. That was a long time, 12 years back, and I don't remember. I think it was MRI. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I had to go through the hoops to find out what it was, and he explained that if they were not severe, medications could be used. If it was worth, that would be angioplasty. And then, of course, the last would be surgery if that's required. And when it was determined that I had 3 arteries blocked, partially blocked, blocked a lot, he explained that they would take a vein from each of my legs and one from my left arm. So I was put in the hospital the next day. That was on a Tuesday. I went in the hospital on a Wednesday. I had surgery on Thursday and was discharged on Monday. And when I woke up from surgery that Thursday, I looked at my left arm, and it was heavily bandaged, so I knew what was going on there. But I moved my legs, and I couldn't feel anything. And finally, I got the nerve to touch one and the other, and there was nothing. So I didn't understand that. When the surgeon came in, I told him how happy I was that they found only one blockage rather than 3. And he laughed and said, no, we found 3. But when we opened your chest cavity, we found your heart muscle strong enough to use arteries from inside of your chest, which means that we bypassed arteries with arteries as opposed to having to use veins. Only one vein was used. And then, and that Monday when I left, he hugged me and said, don't you ever stop that exercise that you're doing. It just served you well. So I said all that to say this. Being slender, trim is one thing, but your health is more important. So you must watch the food intake, your food intake. To me, exercise is and always has been a means for me to firm my muscles, but I've never looked at exercise as a way to lose weight. I always connected that with food intake, and I think that a lot of people will agree with me on that. I could go on and on this, Don, but
that's why you're here.
The exercise program that I use has been developed over the years. It's not, well, actually started with calisthenics, the same ones we used when I was in high school playing football. I just tweaked them a little bit and added some, and I tried to concentrate on my full body. I know a lot of people, when they look in the mirror, they want to flex and see abs and pecs. So they never want to look at the back and see all that flab hanging off. And I tried to concentrate on that too. Plus, I have an exercise that addresses, well, two, the jogging in place, and the other one is what I call hip flex, because I've always been concerned about, I see my peers with a lot of hip replacements, and I've tried to, I don't know that what I do has been successful. I just know I haven't so far, thank the Lord. I haven't had to have hip replacement, and I'm very active. So I have the the hip flex exercise along with jogging in place. And as I said, but the main thing about getting started, and I don't care what your exercise program is, if you don't make the commitment, what you're going to do is you're going to get started, and you're going to stop. So the key is fully making up your mind, this is what I want to do.
Let me ask you that, because, and you are so right there, you know, and it has been said, if you can do something 3 weeks or more, it becomes a routine. But I think that what happens to most of us is that we'll do it for a month, and then we get a little tired, and one morning we'll wake up and say, well, I'm going to wait till tomorrow, because I worked out 4 days last week. And that one day stunned in 2 days. Mm-hmm. When you know anything, you've gone a week, and then you're out of your routine.
Mm-hmm.
In your book, what you said is that you do it with comfort. You do it inside of your house where the inclement weather doesn't bother you. The heat won't stop you, and whatever going on the outside. But when you say you got a 4x6 rug that you do all the exercise on.
No, just one, jogging in place. That's the only exercise I do on the rug.
Oh, I thought you did everything on the rug.
No. I use the hip flex exercise. I use my breakfast bar. In the DVD, I'm in a house, and I'm using the back of a sofa. I just want the grip so I can extend my legs and move the exercise routine that I have. So it's all designed so that you don't have to use equipment.
No excuse.
It's called a no excuses program. If you're in travel status, you say, well, I didn't bring my gizmo, so I can't exercise. Forget it. They have chairs and sofas in there, wherever you are. So you can do it. No excuses. The thing of it is, one day I asked myself, after going up and down, and I know I've been through what you just said about you stop and so forth, and then after you've been on it a while and you see how you begin to look better, you feel better, you go to the doctor, and your doctor says that, oh, what is happening? You're good, okay? So I asked myself the question. First, let me say, exercise to me is not fun.
Now that's what he and I talk about it all the time.
Okay.
You know, it doesn't get easy. And I heard Dawn told me a long time ago, said that if they had a pill, I wouldn't have to be doing this out here.
I'd take a 4-mile pill every morning. It's a 20-push-up pill.
Well, it does not get so. So you have a trade-off. And I asked myself this question. That's in there, the way it went down.
Yeah,
I said, do I like the way exercise makes me feel? Do I like the way I look? Do I like what the doctors are saying about my health? And to me, it was a no-brainer, because when I look at it, you have 24 hours in a day, and all I'm recommending, you can design this however you want it, all I'm recommending is that you do 30 to 40 minutes 3 to 5 days a week. How much time is that out of 24 hours a day? That's the way I look at it. I made the commitment to do it, and when I don't exercise, my body tells me I have to do it.
Now that's something that I get a little I feel cheated. I fear that I'm cheating myself and to get a little guilty when I go too far. But, as long as I've been doing it, I exercise hard. I still don't lack having to get up and go do it every day.
Well,
I do it exactly 3 or 4 days a week. And you get up there, the hardest part about it is getting out of the bed. Now, it helps me a little bit now more because I don't get to the office for 11 or 12. So if I wake up at 6 and decide I don't want to get out to 9, then I can do that. But the best way to do it is have a particular time you get up and do it every day.
I agree with that. And as far as problems getting out of bed, in there I have exercises I do in bed.
That's what I was going to ask you about.
Before I get up.
Yeah,
and that jump starts me. I'm ready to go.
You talking about you exercise your neck and your and
your
face
muscle?
Now, how do you exercise your face muscle?
Well, just by, and I've been warned by someone that I met recently that's destructive to face muscle. So I don't want to get into that.
Are they 79?
No.
They were 79, weren't they? So you keep doing what you're doing.
Let me say this, and you fully understand. She is 68.
Okay.
Yeah. And why are you looking at me like that?
Still got
11
more years to go.
Why am I looking? You know.
Yeah, I mean. Tell it all.
So I've kind of altered that. Yeah.
Okay. So you altered how? Cause the hand was not as smooth. I mean, when the face wasn't as smooth when they fell.
Well, I was told that it destroyed some tissue or something. I didn't understand it, but
you knew that they knew it because they were feeling them.
That's what she does. That's what she does for her other clients. So it's free to me. So.
That's a good one. That was. You told the truth about that. Now that we know why you do these facial exercise, now you say you do your shoulder and your neck. I think that's what I saw.
Well, I think that
the best exercise
that I do, as far as what it does for me, is that's demonstrated on. I've changed a little bit, but lying in bed with my knees bent, I do an exercise with my hands together and going back over just to stretch all of this in here. Mm. And then I go forward to work on the abs. This is in the bed. Mm. It's about 6-7 minutes, so don't be frowning like it's scaring him to death.
Get him!
Okay? But let me say something to you gentlemen right now. Because I hear where this is going. I don't like it. Let me give you a sobering fact. You remember when the doctor was telling me about what I needed to do, and when I found this out, all these blockages, I have never, ever had a pain. Now, I'm walking around about to have a stroke or heart attack without a pain because you look good, you need to check it out. I'm serious about it.
I agree. It's silent killer. That's what you got in there.
Yeah.
So
that's what it is. Yeah. Exactly and what it is.
Now, I saw where you did not exclude eating meat because you said you eat a little egg, you eat a little fish, and you eat some skin chicken and some turkey.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you stay away from red meat.
I had a steak yesterday.
Well, you didn't say nothing about that in the book that you had.
What you said in the book, I read. That's what I do. But I do not deprive myself of some things that I like. On occasion,
steak is
not in my everyday diet. I was in the market and saw these two ribeyes, and I said, hey. So I brought them home, put them in the freezer, and the other day I was out of, I said, well, I know what I can have. And so I'll buy it again in a couple of 3 months or when I think it's not anything I go around thinking about like you do.
Okay. Yeah. Now what happens when you go to the restaurant? Now you said that just because it tastes good, mm-hmm. you shouldn't overeat. You're supposed to stop when you get full. Mm-hmm. When something is good, sometimes you don't know that you full until you've eaten too much of it.
Well, you ever hear of a doggy bag or takeout bag that restaurants have? You need to utilize those. What goes through your mind probably is, I paid for this.
I don't know about his mind, but you just got mine.
So I'm asking you to consider eating some of it later. Okay, but I know how it is. I've been there when you pay for it, and I can't leave this.
Yep. Well. You have. That book is, it is designed. You know, as I read it, it was designed for me, because your thoughts, all of that you, I mean, not wanting to get up, hating the inclement weather. You actually solved a lot of problems, because most of us think we got to get up and go to the gym. We got to get this expensive equipment. And you just, as you said, no excuse. You just knocked that out of the park. Get up, because you can think about it, and I've often thought about it. The good Lord gave us everything that we need
to do.
What we should do for our body, yeah. You know. But sometimes our taste bud, you know, just said, "Look here, this cake is too good to just have one piece. Now, you know, two pieces ain't gone. And when you know anything, half the cake is gone."
Here's something I want you to try, and let me give you the story behind it. I was almost an ice cream addict at one time.
Sound like me.
Okay. I would go to the store and buy a half gallon of ice cream. I would put some in a bowl, small bowl, and eat it. And I'd go back to the refrigerator and fill it up and eat another one. And I would eat until I'm filled. But the desire for that, I'm just stuffed, so I'm miserable. The desire for that taste does not leave me. I still want some more. Okay? I still want some more. So I tried forcing myself to take a small portion and live with it. In other words, when you finish the small portion, you're going to want some more. If you finish a larger portion, you're going to want some more. So why not just live with the small portion? It's got so now, I rarely think of sweets. By the way, I have on top of my refrigerator some chocolate chip cookies, and she says that chocolate, that dark chocolate... It's good for me.
I was hoping you didn't go there.
But I eat when I think I want something sweet, I'll eat one cookie and I'm finished. I mean, I just want that taste and it's gone.
Yeah, but you have to
make sure that people know that you didn't just wake up and was able to do that. You had to get to the point that you had to be disciplined, because that's my issue. I do wrong, and I know I'm doing wrong with the sweets. I mean, I'm the kind of person that I'm addicted to sugar, but I know it, so I try to address it the best way I can. But I wouldn't be happy until all of those cookies were gone.
I understand that.
But I'd be okay after that. For a minute.
Your psychological. Head, yeah, but your body is not.
My body.
That's what I'm talking about.
Look, one of the things that, let's see, we didn't do a show last week. Did we do one the week before? Anyway, since the shows we've done, in the last 2 weeks, I have come on to know two other people that now have been diagnosed with gout. Both of these people had to end up going to the hospital. One shoulder, and the other one was leg and foot. Well, feet, I should say, because both of her feet were. And now that's a buildup condition. That what happens is that uric acid just, you know, you keep eating the meat and you keep drinking the alcohol and you keep doing all this stuff and it just builds up. So you get a pain, but you kind of ignore it because you're not sure what it is. And then it gets to the point where it gets to the, it will cripple you. It hurts so bad. I mean, you don't want a sheet to touch your arm, your foot, or nothing. But what happens is, what I'm thinking is that most of these people don't understand how important it is to have that balance that you have. And especially both of these are older people. I mean, not old, but older people. Older people, 60s plus. Yeah, you old too, and me too. But what's your recommendations on eating on a daily basis? Because I noticed what you eat, but I know that took discipline for you to finally get to that point, or did it?
Of course. Like I said, I was brought up on fried everything right up the street, up in Cascade Heights, where I was born. It was...
You're born in Cascade Heights?
Right up on Heron Road.
So you're born in Richfield.
Uh-oh.
I was born... You know where the post office is up there on Heron Road?
Yeah, that's where rich folks live.
No,
black folks over in there.
No, the whole street. There were two streets of blacks. I was born, and when I say born there, literally in a house on the next hill in 1932. You remember that?
Yeah, he probably does. He was probably here because I think he on his second time around.
Well, I want to talk to him about gout. I've been
Okay.
Gout. Those meats that where you get a lot of uric acid, but what I found, because I became interested in that stuff, is painful, is that it seems that uric acid is in, I won't say most foods, but it's in a lot of different foods. Like in spinach, you like spinach?
Oh yeah, I know it's in there.
Like in oatmeal.
Oatmeal, so asparagus.
All of the healthy stuff.
That's right. That's okay. Supposed to be healthy.
But now there's one thing I want you to reconsider. That you said, one item.
Okay.
And there's a reason for this. You said an alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And let me explain about alcohol. Alcohol, is my understanding, does not build up in the uric acid. The uric acid comes from other sources. Alcohol crystallizes it. And that's where your pain comes from.
Well, I'm here to tell you, they need to get rid of that alcohol. Because the funny thing is, now I've had some bouts with it, and the alcohol wasn't a part of mine.
Okay.
But I didn't have it to the extent. The first time I had it, it was like a wake-up call. I had never had pain like that before in my life. In fact, that was the first time I went to the hospital since birth. But I had inflammation in my shoulder. And I say, Lord, look, if it's time for me to go, just go ahead and take me, because that's how bad that pain was.
It is awful. I've had always in my feet. Mm. It's always been in my feet. And like you said, I couldn't stand for a sheet to touch.
Yeah. And that's, they gave me morphine. Yeah. Anything they gave me, it was like, that's all you got. That's what the pain was saying. That's all you got. You got to give me more than that. But anyway, I think that what we need to do is we need to make sure we address, you know, like you were saying, some of the things. Now, the last bout I had with it was because of the oatmeal. And I had no idea. I was eating oatmeal every day and drinking hot tea every day. The two worst things you could do for gal. And I didn't know it. But I got this book called Nutritional Healing, and it tells you all of the foods you can eat and, like spinach. You thought that would have been good because I have to go to a raw diet in order to flush my system to get it gone. But anyway, that was just one issue that I'm seeing that older people now are starting to define themselves because they think they can still eat like they used to. I tell folks I had my best meals yesterday because I can't eat like I used to, not even in moderation. But you have done an excellent job in taking care of yourself, and hopefully this book will help take care of some other people. And the book is called Weight Control for Middle Aged and Senior Citizens. Mr. Jackson, you in here. Middle-aged. And
there is a website.
Okay.
The website for this book and DVD is www.weightcontroloptions.com. That's www.weightcontroloptions.com. When you go to that website, the phone number is on it.
Well,
and also means of purchasing it if it's through PayPal. The booklet is the booklet and DVD together, $14.99. That's plus shipping
and handling.
And you know, when it depends on how it's being marketed, if somebody purchases it online, it's going to have the shipping charge on it. But otherwise, and then we've under certain circumstances where people. Senior citizens, we'll discount the book.
Yeah. Now, one thing, too, that we pretty much hadn't talked about is the physical part we can definitely see and see that you've really taken care of yourself in that extent. And your diet apparently had a whole lot to do with that. But the other thing that I'm noticing is your sharpness, your mental state.
Thank you.
And the food, is there any special, does the fish help more than the chicken, or
well,
are there any particular foods that's keeping you sharp?
I'm struggling with myself now on a particular kind of fish that I need to have inside of me, and it's salmon.
Yeah.
Now, my son loves it. He could eat it every day. I don't like salmon.
Right.
I don't like broccoli.
Yeah.
But
I've learned to like.
I make a juice. I never mentioned this, but I make a juice, vegetable juice from 7 different kinds of vegetables. I go to the farmer's market. I have a juicer, and I know it's said that when you make juice, you should drink it instantly. But it's my feeling that the way I make it, I have half pint freezer cups. It's all lined up. When I juice, it goes into a container. I immediately put it in another one, cover it until I'm finished with my juicing. Then I pour it and immediately cap it, and I freeze it.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to lose something,
but I'm
not going to lose everything.
Right.
And I cannot make myself juice every day.
Yeah, that would be my issue, too.
So that's why I do it the way I do it. I lose something, yeah, but
sense.
I'm getting something.
That makes sense.
So.
Well, that's good.
So, go ahead. So that fruit keeps you sharp.
I eat fruit. I juice vegetables.
One question, don't finish. I like to put mine in a blender and blend it all up, then pour some juice over there and make it so I can drink it. Is that diluting it or something. See, I dump all my fruits over in the blender and blend.
I dump all my vegetables in there. So I'm saying I don't think so. I think it's good. Now, I'm not an expert on that. I make that disclaimer in here. I'm not a nutritionist. I depend on the advice.
Well, okay, you're not an expert. Uh-huh.
But
you're old and all expert. So you tell me what the expert, you know. These experts said, well, you know, we did a study. We had 100 folks this and 100 folks that.
And they sitting there with 250 pounds.
You got a self-study. You studied yourself for that long. So you talk about what actually worked.
Yeah, it works for me. And that's important. You can take a little bit from that program, get it so it suits you.
Right.
And that's what I do is not just a... It was not a program design that I came up with all at once. And so I like to make me comfortable. What I do may not be comfortable to you.
Well, that's what your book says.
And I've always had the feeling that there are certain exercises, strenuous exercises, that people do, then you can do less strenuous exercises and get the same benefit. And that's what I've tried to accomplish.
Well, we have had a dynamic spoken word today on the middle age and the old folks, how to live. And Mr. Henry Morgan he does not proclaim to be an expert, but as Don and I have spoken to and have interviewed more self-help folks and people tell us how to live, then we got toes and fingers together, and he's the most believable one. I mean, he shows here.
He's proof of the pudding.
Proof of the pudding. Some of these other folks come here young and fat and telling us how to eat. You're living it. We want to thank you for tuning in. We appreciate you, your patience for him getting here, and we'll see you next week at the same time. Thank you.
I'm going to tell this.
If you see me in the